All right, well, welcome everyone. I am April Barton and I am the dean of this outstanding law school. And I am thrilled beyond words to be kicking off this spectacular event, a conversation with nationally renowned trial attorney Thomas R. Kline. Tom Kline is regarded universally as the consummate trial attorney of his generation and is among America's most respected and influential lawyers. He is also, I'm proud to say, a distinguished graduate of Duquesne University School of Law. We are truly honored that he is here with us today. His many groundbreaking cases have helped shape the law and have resulted in corporate, institutional, and governmental change and justice for his clients. In addition to impressive verdicts and settlements that have helped improve the lives of his clients and others, he cares about making things right. Kline and Specter cases have resulted in safety improvements in medical care, consumer products, mass transit, motor vehicles, public utilities, and more. Our 1L students in this room, remember that during your very first day of 1L orientation, I asked you to consider for a moment why you came to law school. And I know there are a number of reasons, but I guess that at least one of those reasons was to learn how to make a difference in the world around you. Our profession shapes societies, informs governments. It's the bedrock of justice and rule of law. And I believe there is no more powerful way to make a dent than to be an attorney. By coming to law school, you develop a gift, a superpower, if you will, and that is the art of advocacy. Not only can you advocate for the issues that you believe in, but you can advocate for those who are unable to advocate for themselves. You can change the lives of others with the words that you write and speak. Tom Kline is truly the epitome, the very embodiment of an advocate extraordinaire who has used his superpower of advocacy to make a powerful difference. Thank you, Tom, on behalf of Duquesne Law, not only for making us tremendously proud of your magnificent career and your success, and grateful for your unmatched generosity to our School of Law, but for making an impact, for making a positive dent in the world around us. Here to formally introduce Mr. Kline is our law school's former dean, who is now president of the university, Ken Gornley. President Gornley joined Duquesne in 1994, serving as professor and then dean of the School of Law, where he led a transformation that led the law school to national prominence. In July of 2016, he took office as the leader of the entire university. Please welcome the 13th president of Duquesne University, Ken Gornley.
Thank you very much, Dean Barton. Good afternoon, everyone. It is wonderful to see all these faces here, especially on a Friday afternoon. So that's a real tribute to our speaker here. And I know that it will be an inspiring but also an enjoyable day for all of you as you have a chance to hear from one of this law school's most accomplished alumni, Tom Kline. I've been fortunate enough to know Tom for many years now. His picture is literally on the cover of the magazines that list best lawyers in Pennsylvania every year. He's consistently among the best lawyers in the United States in recognition. While studying at Duquesne Law School, like all of you are, Tom excelled in every facet of legal studies, particularly trial and appellate moot court. He received the Distinguished Student Award, which is given out every year to the graduating student who most embodies the traditions of excellence and service to others, which of course define the mission of this law school. After graduation, Tom landed a very competitive clerkship with the Pennsylvania Supreme Court, working with Justice Thomas Pomeroy, then entered private practice at the very prestigious Beasley firm in Philadelphia before forming Kline and Specter, along with then-Senator Arlen Specter's son, Shane Specter. And that firm has been described as by the Philadelphia Inquirer as one of the country's foremost personal injury firms, and it is indeed one of the country's foremost law firms. His many groundbreaking cases have helped to shape, as Dean Barton said, law and achieve justice for his clients in a whole realm of different areas. He's racked up many landmark victories, and just this month he won a jury verdict against a drug manufacturer in the amount of $8 billion. That's billion with a B. The largest verdict ever in the state and one of the largest in the country. 2 years ago, what you may or may not know, especially for you 1Ls, is that Tom made a generous gift to this law school, enabling us to create the Thomas R. Kline Center for Judicial Education. This groundbreaking center partners with the Administrative Office of the Pennsylvania Courts, which is under the umbrella of the Pennsylvania Supreme Court, along with the other 8 law schools in Pennsylvania to provide high quality and innovative continuing education courses to over 600 judges, both trial and appellate judges in Pennsylvania. It's truly a model for the rest of the country. There really is nowhere else that has this sort of partnership with the courts, and we're very proud of it. The creation of the new Kline Center, which is right up on the 4th floor next to the faculty lounge, reflects Tom Kline's own lifelong reverence for the judicial system that enables the broader constitutional system that you're starting to learn about and the system of laws to work properly, and his belief in teaching and education are central as vehicles to enrich the professional development of everyone, including the most experienced jurists. Tom Kline grew up in very modest surroundings in Hazleton, PA. Some of you are probably from Central PA. Yet he's risen to the top of his profession because he's always prepared. He always puts the interests of his clients first, and he believes deeply in the system of laws that enables it to achieve fairness and equity, especially for those clients who otherwise wouldn't have access to this system of justice. So please join me in welcoming our distinguished alums, one of the most generous benefactors of this law school in its 108-year history, and a great friend personally who is truly one of the most caring and extraordinary people I've ever met, Mr. Tom Kline.
So you came for a free lunch. That's really what this is all about. I'm here to talk to you today, not to talk at you, but talk with you. And I'm here to talk about whatever you'd like to talk about. We can revisit Paul's graph if you'd like, or that's how you can tell where people are in the courts. I just spent a class in contracts with international students at the Drexel Kline School of Law, talking about that PepsiCo case everybody read. It's like the fun case. So we can talk about that. I actually know about that because that wasn't taught when I was in law school. The first thing I learned, what's the first name of the plaintiff? Leonard? Is it Leonard versus PepsiCo? It's the case. It's the case with the jet.
Yeah, yeah, so you're
paying, Dean, they're paying attention.
Yeah. They're waiting for you to call them.
And the question is, was it really an offer? You know, was it offer acceptance consideration? And how many think that was a bona fide offer? I think it was. That's a whole other story. And the reason I think it was is because there was a second ad where they actually, if you go on YouTube, you'll see that there was a second ad where they changed the number of points to buy the jet. It was a Mirage jet. I assume we forget.
Harrier.
Yeah, Harrier jet, yeah. Now we're talking.
Yeah.
And it was a Harrier jet, and they had a second ad, and they changed it to a couple hundred million points, proving my point that they really were serious in the first instance, only they put down the wrong amount. So I like to spend time in classrooms. I poke myself in classrooms when I'm allowed and invited. And I'm happy to be here with you all. It's great to see everyone. You also now know that I not only believe that we need to educate law students, but we need to educate judges. And so that's where we put a stake down in judicial education. You never stop learning as a lawyer. That's really the truth of the matter. So let's talk. Who came with questions? You have to, and there's no question that, if you learned one thing in law school, there's no question too dumb to ask. You can ask any question you want today, and I will either be a lawyer and answer the question, or a politician and jump over the question. Let's have some fun. And you can eat while we're doing this, like it's not impolite. You're here to have lunch.
All right, so recently the Health Law Society put on a documentary, it was called To Heirs to Human, in which they talked about malpractice claims, things like that. And I just want to know, in your opinion, what do you think can be done from, in terms of maybe procedure side, to reduce the amount of like medical malpractice issues that arise?
Well, we can start by reducing medical malpractice. That would be a starting point. There's a misconception, I believe, which comes from a well-oiled propaganda machine that has to do with trying to convince the public that there's something wrong with the lawyers and not something wrong with the medical care. We have 100,000 people who die from medical negligence or medical errors every year, and so those claims need to be adjudicated in the courts. What I have found in now 40 years of doing this work, if you read the bio, I assume that's why you asked the question, because I've handled a lot of medical malpractice cases. You will see that the cases find their way through the court system, and literally the cases that you read as first year, this is not a friendly mic. I think we face it. Hello.
Did you prefer I have a handheld?
Let's try this. Anyway, that's a short answer, and a longer answer I'll be happy to give you if you buttonhole me. I'm around all day and hopefully for a long time to come. Next. Yes, sir. All the hands that were up went down now.
What's the case of your career you would say you're the most proud of?
All of them? No. There was a case in 1999 that I tried for a little boy who lost his foot in an escalator in Philadelphia. And it appeared to be a routine negligence case involving a transit authority, which under Pennsylvania law, there is a limitation on the amount of damages that can be recovered, only $250,000. And in that case, we succeeded in not only compensating that little boy, you can read about it on the website, Hall versus Septa, but more importantly, we were able to effectuate broad-scale institutional change. We had an escalator system which was in deplorable condition, unknown to the public. We brought it to the public's attention in a month-long saga that played itself out on the local news. We had every escalator of the broken-down Philadelphia system repaired in a promise at the end of the day. And what I learned out of that case was that something larger than one individual's claim can be done in the civil justice system. And I set my goal from that day forward, and it was, as I like to say, mid-career, maybe beginning of the career, But it was an eye-opener to me what we were able to do and how we were able to effectuate change. And I set myself on the trajectory from that case, and our law firm, frankly, on the trajectory, and the plaintiffs are on a trajectory, I would hope, towards achieving that kind of reform out of smaller cases. You always have your first and foremost obligation to a client, but the client's good is not inconsistent with the public good by any means. And so I think that's the case that made the difference to me. There were a lot of things that followed that, the Sandusky a case where I think we did an enormous amount of good and still are doing good on the issue of preventing sexual violence on college campuses and to children. And if you read anything about what I've been currently doing with a remarkable, two remarkable parents of a young man who died at Penn State, probably the hero, and some of you in this room were there, Timothy Piazza, we've now reached over, literally touched over 100,000 college students face-to-face through their advocacy, and I'm very proud of being part of that, changing the law in Pennsylvania, literally, you know, leather on the bottom of your shoes in the Capitol building in Harrisburg to get a law passed called the Timothy J. Piazza Anti-Hazing Law. I wasn't hired to change the law. I was hired to represent a grieving parents who were looking for some recourse. And by definition, my job was to get them compensation, because that's all the civil justice system will allow me to do as a legal matter. But as a practical matter, I could do an awful lot more, and we have done an awful lot more. And that's the proudest current accomplishment. I haven't mentioned the verdict, and that's a separate thing I'd be happy to talk about, but I've spent this year, in my 41st year of practicing law, I think I've spent 23 weeks on trial in a courtroom this year, trying drug and device product liability cases, mainly. So I'm trying to show you also you can stay active a long time. You can do this and like it. I've been very fortunate. There are studies that are done on well-being of lawyers, and you all, in my view, I'm going to take the other mic. This is just fading in and out. Let's see if this is better. Yeah, a lot better. There are studies, literally one empirical study, which I often talk about, especially with younger lawyers, on happiness of lawyers. And happiness of lawyers is being a lawyer, and someday hopefully all of you in this room will be lawyers or doing something that's related to the law. And happiness is not related to money. Happiness is actually related, the studies show, to doing good and to being fulfilled that you've actually done good. The most happy lawyers are lawyers in the public interest sector, by far. And the most unhappy lawyers, empirical studies show, are the lawyers that are in large law firms making the most money. So, who'd have thunk it? But it's eye-opening and something to consider. That's not to say it's inconsistent with making a good living as a lawyer and doing something that you like to do, and it's also not inconsistent with defending corporate interests, defending institutional interests, or representing individuals who bring claims against those institutions. But what is important is that you yourself find self-satisfaction. I've been really fortunate because I love what I do every day that I get up and I do it. Because I still feel a purpose, I still feel a need, I still feel an accomplishment, little and small. That's, if there's a message that I convey from that question, now that I've drifted far afield, that would be my advice. If I said, remember one thing that Tom Kline told you today, that's what I would tell you, unless I tell you something else really coming up shortly.
Thank you.
Yes. Oh, I love it. It's a lot of questions.
When it comes to the automation of cars,
I think you're asking me when we have cars without drivers, who are we going to sue? and the answer is anyone who designed it improperly or even imperfectly. I mean, there's a brave new world out there. If you were, it's very interesting. Yesterday, I spent 4 hours on a panel talking to our state trial judges. There were 80 judges who were spread throughout the Commonwealth at remote locations, and we were talking about medical records, if I can divert and answer the question obliquely. And it's very interesting because they presented, an alum of this law school and a good friend of mine and 40-year practitioner of medical malpractice and defense work, and the CEO of Dickey McCamey, John Conti, was talking about these issues, and he brought in someone from UPMC from the medical records department, the electronic medical records department, because all medical records are electronic because it's mandated by the federal government, and institutions, large medical systems, spend billions of dollars developing these complex systems. And we were talking about in the old days versus the new days. And in the old days, I hope this answers your point without talking about cars and driverless cars. In the old days, if a doctor read or didn't read an x-ray, you would question the doctor. You would have a written note, reviewed x-ray. Maybe the note would be timed, maybe it wouldn't. You'd have evidence, direct evidence. You didn't take evidence. But you would have direct evidence, okay. not circumstantial evidence, as to what the primary actor did or didn't do. Today, you call the computer person from the institution, from in this case UPMC, to try to find out if there's an audit trail, which is an electronic log of when a person entered or didn't enter. So you're no longer asking the doctor, you're asking some computer person whether the doctor actually made an entry or didn't make an entry in a chart. So you're now one person removed from the primary actor. Technology has changed the practice, the medical malpractice practice, in that way, and so have all kinds of issues as technologies advance. Will there be driverless cars? Maybe not the way things are headed, but maybe so. And if they are, will there be design defects in the first batch? Yes. Will there be litigation? Yes. Will there be people badly injured? Yes. Will they need representation? Yes. Will the corporations who design the cars just turn over all the documents and all the emails which say, geez, we knew this was a problem? I mean, it's the Boeing Max case that you see playing out in the newspapers. Yes. I want to answer every question. That's my goal.
First of all, thank you for being here.
Thank you for having me. We used to go to law school at Rockwell Hall before they had a bistro. And the walls were cement. I was telling Ken Gormley today, you know that dream that you have? I think you have it the older you get, the more you have this dream. The dream where you're still in school, where you haven't prepared for the exam, where you don't know the material, where you can't get there because you're late. How many of you have had that dream? Well, my dream is that dream, only it's in Rockwell Hall, and the walls are cement brick blocks. If you get that dream, it kind of like think prison. And you are in you're like in a real law school setting. We didn't have this room, but yes.
Well, sort of related to that, if you could go back.
You asked me to be your guest. I'm like the guy who you invited to dinner and you said you didn't invite him.
But if you could go back in time and meet Tom Kline 1L, what do you think he would be most surprised by and what would you tell him?
He'd be surprised that he's here talking to all of you and that you really wanted to hear him talk about this. And I would tell him the same thing that I tell 1Ls whenever I get a chance to talk to them as often as I can, which is, if you know the expression, and you may have to Google this because some of you will not know it because I know it anecdotally, you won't know it, put your nose to the grindstone. It's all about work. I tell young lawyers who come into our office or people who are interviewing who want the job, like I want to work at Kline and Specter, I want to work with Tom Kline, I tell them one thing, which I think answers your question. It's not all glory. It's all about making the sausage, you're not eating the sausage. And it's hard work. It's hard work. If you were to see me last month, every night back in the office, every night trying to figure out that last bit of good stuff that I could use on cross-examination, that's what I would tell Tom Kline then. I mean, I had an interesting progression. I know some of you have read, how many have read something about it? I assume if you came here, you might have seen something about it. I mean, I was a kid who grew up in Hazleton. Who's from Hazleton, by the way? Wilkes-Barre, Scranton, like someplace near home, Williamsport. I was a kid from Hazleton. I went to Hazleton Senior High School, and I graduated and I went to Albright College, not Harvard. And I went back and I taught school for 6 years. That was the best thing that I ever did. I taught sixth graders for 6 years. As I like to say, not a cup of coffee, not like your bragging rights, for 6 years, and I loved it. But I knew I wanted to go to law school. On my way out of Hazleton, my dad said to me, "Why are you leaving? You and my late wife Paula, we were both teachers. She taught fifth grade, I taught sixth grade. I got a preview of sixth graders because I knew the bad kids were." Because my wife was teaching them. And I, literally talked my way in here. Part of the official story, like I never say it this way because I never kind of really liked it in print this way, but I talked my way in off the waiting list. And Assistant Dean Shula was here at the time, and the doors were open here. I think they're still wide open. And all I knew was that I had like a sense that I wanted to help people. I wanted to be a lawyer. I knew that in my mind that there was some connection. Yes, I had seen TV shows, although not like you see TV shows today. And I'm sorry, I have this tendency to lean in. And I just felt, that I kind of had a place where I wanted to get, and I ended up here, and it was a perfect fit. I needed a place that was going to teach me the skills and the fundamentals. I'm still a firm believer in fundamentals. Fundamentals are hard. I am a huge NBA fan, and when I see, and I'm a huge 76ers fan, and when I see Ben Simmons shooting 60% from the foul line, I think fundamentals, like shoot 10,000 shots and you will make more of them at game time. And so I got here that way. I don't know if I answered your question, but I kind of said what I wanted to say.
That works, thank you.
Okay, if it doesn't, you tell me, yes.
How do you make time for yourself? I know you said you were, like, nose to the grindstone and everything like that, but I've tried today, like, work-life balance.
That is really a great question. That's as important a question as can be asked here, because it's a corollary to be happy, really a corollary to being happy. You will never, if you practice law at a high level, or you are a law professor at a high level, or you are a member of the judiciary, as many of the graduates of this law school proudly are, You will never get it perfect. It's just too complicated. It's especially complicated for women, but much more complicated than men. We've always had it easier. And that was a laugh button. Really have had it easier. But I've tried, and I hope I succeeded. I spend every last minute that I can with my grandkids now and my kids. I have three kids. I am fortunate enough to be able to build a house next to my house at the Jersey Shore so that they come and so that I have them with me. And I think I have a pretty good balance, but I don't think it's perfect. And I think that that's something you have to work at. You have to shut off the phones, and it's hard. It's harder now than it ever was. And you have to go to dinner with whoever you love the most and put your iPhone in your pocket. You just have to do it. And you have to tell your mate or your brother or sister to, let's turn it off. Let's talk. There are so many, let's be philosophical. There are so many, in addition to work life, there are so many other impediments to human relationships today, which are, in my opinion, at the core of the disintegration of various aspects of our human life. That's a far-reaching answer to a short question as to how you balance it. I spend it with my family. I go away. I hang out at the shore. I love to go to New York. I have a son who is, interestingly, a law school graduate and a member of the bar, but who is a playwright by profession. And he's given me a lot of balance because I see that there is a great way to be happy. I have a daughter who is a preschool teacher for the last 15 or 18 years, however many years. I know the kids who she has are now near adulthood. And I actually look forward to those things. I pride myself in reading text messages in court. And because those are the important things. Yes, sir. You deserve it.
Oh, thank you.
Go
back. Drexel grad, actually. I was a junior at the time of law school, got dedicated to you. My roommate was in the inaugural 1L class. He's got nothing but good things to say about Drexel Hall. But you said you were teaching
Kline School of Law.
Kline School of Law, I know.
as I like to say, for another 50 million, they will actually. That's okay.
But you said you were a teacher for 6 years before coming to law school. Did you come to law school knowing exactly what you wanted to do? It was torts from the beginning, so basically,
no.
Why torts, and if not, no. Torts, did you have interest in anything else?
If you knew my torts grade, you would say anybody can succeed at this. But no, I really didn't. My career track was, and this I encourage, my career track was that I got a clerkship. I was fortunate to get a clerkship on the Pennsylvania Supreme Court. I was more fortunate to get a clerkship with I would like to think, and I know, the preeminent justice of the Supreme Court at the time. That helps. But it also helps if you get a clerkship on the Common Pleas Court. Or it helps if you go across a state line and get a clerkship in your home state, because that puts you in a network of individuals who are practicing law and gives you a grounding. For me, it gave me a firm grounding in appellate law, spending a year as a law clerk on the Pennsylvania Supreme Court. I then, interestingly, I was a small town kid, if you remember the bio now. Small town kid, and I wasn't going to take a small town. I was going to take a smaller than small town. I went back to Pottsville to teach, or to, not to teach, to practice law. We were there for about a month. I got the only ultimatum from my late wife, Paula, which was, if you're staying, I'm not. And I looked for a job, and it's not all like, I just don't believe in a life where you say, I know there are people who do this, where you say,
peg, bing, like that. I just don't believe in that. I was told by a friend of mine that there was a lawyer in Philadelphia who I'd seen argue in the Supreme Court of Pennsylvania. His name was James E. Beasley. James E. Beasley is the benefactor of the Beasley School of Law at Temple. I call it the Beasley School. A lot of people just say, I go to Temple. That's fine. That's cool. There is a university there, and they're entitled to recognition, too. Like, you know, take the name off the door. The So, you won't forget this conversation. That's because law school is a process of embarrassing you in front of 150 other people. But I was told, don't apply to Beasley, because he is expletive, and a bunch of stuff, but I wasn't going to take that for an answer, and I applied, and he just kind of hired me. Like, you want the job? Yeah. When can you start? January 1st, Beasley. I don't want you to have to work on New Year's Day. That was a joke. And then I showed up January 2nd, and he marched off to court with me. And he was a great trialer, which is lesson number 15 or 16 from Tom Kline today, which is find yourself a great mentor. Find yourself somebody who is skillful, experienced, kind-hearted, and all of the things that you want to have a professional to learn the skills. And I got that from Jim Beasley. Jim Beasley wasn't a teacher. Jim wasn't, you can do it this way, you can do it this way, you can do it this way. Jim was, come with me and watch me. And so that's the way that I learned. And being there 15 or 16 years, along came this young kid whose name was Shane Specter. Shane is one of the preeminent lawyers in the United States. And he and I decided we were going to leave together and formed a partnership. And that's lesson number 17 or 18, whatever we're at, which is if you're going to go into a partnership with someone you love, respect, admire, and who's your equal. Because partnerships are equals. And so you have to do that. There's an old adage, I'll throw in for good measure, free of charge, which is if you get in a partnership, try to do 60%. Because the other person will think they're doing 60%. And if you're in a 50-50 partnership, try to, every day you get up, do 60%. You got your money's worth.
Hi. With a prominent career like yours, adversity's got to be common. How do you navigate moments like that?
What is common?
Adversity.
Adversity? That's an insightful question. I don't spend most of my time with people who are saying, wow, Tom, you're great. I spend more of my time with people pushing back, because we have an adversarial system. And so adversity comes with the territory. What I have learned on a personal level is to try to deactivate adversity in my personal life. And that would be us in 19. But I deactivate it. I look for no drama, for no controversy, for none of the things that are in my personal life. But if you put me in a courtroom and you say something that's wrong, and he's the judge, and we're standing at a sidebar, I will say, that is wrong. He knows that's wrong. And here's why. That's adversity. But it's part of our adversarial process. And some people are not constitutionally fit to do that. And there are so many other great things that you can do in law. You can be a mediator and bring everybody together. But there are all areas of law which are not as adversarial as what we think of ourselves most of the time as 1Ls. You go back to the question, what was I thinking as a 1L? I think we all kind of, because we're seeing cases that are litigated, think of ourselves as adversarial and litigators, and this is what I have to do. And I think some people naturally, in fact, I think a large majority, maybe a majority of you say to yourself, this isn't constitutionally what I wanted to fight with somebody for the rest of my life. But that's not what practicing law is necessarily all about. Oftentimes, the practice of law is trying to bring people together. Some of what I think are my best achievements, and I'll pick one thing, like I'll pick on Penn State a little bit today, but has been building bridges with Penn State in the two cases where I've been their main adversary, is trying to build a better future. Well, at the end of the day, what you want to try to get out of it is to try to build something that will constructively benefit not only the individual litigants, but the better of the community. Sure. Yes. Hi. We can just pass that close by the end.
So I spent my past summer working at a pro bono office, and one of the most shocking moments to me was learning we could not take any cases that had any potential receiving fees or damages. So any torts claims or civil rights claims, anything like that, we couldn't do. So I was wondering, since the system is super important to have and it's important for people to achieve justice, what can we do to expand our resources so everyone can access our legal system?
I mean, some pro bono organizations do. Some pro bono organizations send cases to lawyers and take referral fees. So it depends on the situation. There are cases that are not taken for various reasons, sometimes because they're economically unattractive. And so those are cases that end up in the pro bono system. And those cases are oftentimes really important. And they actually make law, and oftentimes they get the attention of courts because they understand that the lawyers who are in those cases are in them solely and exclusively for the cause and for the client, the two C's, not to make the buck. I don't think I can do better than that. I can't change that whole system.
In a field like personal injury, how do you compartmentalize your emotions when dealing with clients that have been really just torn down?
Also really insightful. It's not easy. It's complex. Life is complex. And it's very hard for you to get to know someone really well who's a quadriplegic. I know many. I mean, just say to yourself, oh my God, you cry with them. But I've cried in front of juries. I've cried myself. And I've wept with clients. But there's a measure of maybe not compartmentalizing, but of understanding that you have to also live your life. I mean, I've in my life, and I had some tragedy, and you have to learn to live beyond that tragedy, whether it's yours or someone else. And it's just part of living. And I hate to say to you, but the older you get, the more you understand that. And it's just it's just part of life. There's a flip side to it. You can't get too emotionally involved. I mean, the people need us. They need us because they need our brains and they need our skill and they need our level of education. And so they need us clinically. Not much different than they need the physician who's going to heal them. We're part of that healing process. And it's but that doesn't deprive us of having a life. I don't think Jim Piazza would mind if I said this in this courtroom, but he and I have a laugh together, a lot, and we've cried together. And that life's kind of that mix. Life really has that mix to it. And it's we're in a unique position, and we have to say we can better the world and better people's lives if we just keep plugging. And the mic off.
In the back?
Go back.
Mr. Kline, there's some water there for you.
There's what? Oh, thanks.
What do you remember? What do you remember from your first trial?
Losing. But the case involved Mildred Hayes, and Mrs. Hayes was dropping off a package at the post office. That's an antique concept. In Germantown. How many? Where's the Philly people? Yay. I was never a Philly guy until I went to Philly. She then ran across the street and was hit by a SEPTA trolley. And my boss, Jim Beasley, told me that I was going to try the case next week and that I would have to learn everything I could about the braking system of the trolley, because this case involved the braking of the trolley, the brake system of the trolley. I never expected to be talking about Mildred Hayes today, but since you asked. And what I didn't know was in the personal injury world of auto accidents, there was such a thing as a dart out case. How many know that expression? A dart out case is when somebody darts in front of the other vehicle and there's not enough time to stop, and you ain't gonna win that case. And I remember two things about the case. One, I told you already, losing. Second thing I remember is that Beasley sent me to ride the trolley so that I could learn how the braking system worked, and he told me to go to the bookkeeper and get the money to go to ride the trolley. And I said to him, don't worry about it, Jim, I got it covered. The trolley was 50 cents. And he said to me, and here's how I knew he was a good boss. He said, I don't want you to put one penny out of your pocket that is a client cost. So I went to Florence, the bookkeeper, and got the dollar, because Beasley told me to do it. And I rode the trolley, and I learned how the braking system worked. And I marched over to court, and I tried the case, and 12 people sent us home 3 days later. That's the first case I tried. The first case that I tried, which was really good, there were a lot of really good things, was about 3 years later. I was only practicing law 3 years. And there was a case involving a woman, Janet Reef, her name was, who had been injured by a defective device, which was known as the Dalcon Shield. The Dalcon Shield was an intrauterine device. It was a defective device, and the company eventually went bankrupt as a result of it. It had a shield which was implanted into the uterus, and then it had a string for the removal of the device. And the device was open at the bottom, and therefore it wicked bacteria into the uterus, and that caused all kinds of catastrophic damage to women, and it was abject corporate stupidity, in my view. There was testimony that was developed on videotape by lawyers of one of the key company witnesses who went to his superior and said, in good conscience, I have to tell you we have this problem. And he was told, so he testified, that, quote, your conscience doesn't pay your salary. And that became pivotal testimony. And I wasn't a volunteer, but Beasley decided that he was busy and didn't want to try the case, and said, on 2 weeks' notice, Tom, you go down to try this case with, Anne will help you. Anne was a lawyer, actually the former president of Temple's wife, Anne Lee, of course. Anne taught me everything I could know in 2 weeks, which wasn't enough to really do anything. I tried the case, and the jury came back. I tried the case in federal court in front of the chief judge of the district, who was not a coddler, if you will. He was a very difficult man. The jury came back and awarded $5.3 million. And I went back to the office and Beasley said, did you get a verdict? Yes, I did. How did you do? Because I wanted to make them work for it. I said, we got to find this verdict. This is how you treat your boss. And he said, okay, how much? I said, $5.3 million, just like you. Can I leave for the day? And that's the case I'd like to remember rather than Mildred Hayes. And I was a three-year lawyer at the time, third-year lawyer. We have lawyers in our office who have had similar circumstances. If you go to our website, you don't go to my page. Go to the pages of some of our younger lawyers who have had these spectacular verdicts, because we actually try cases. We believe that the civil justice system is important, that the courts should be open, and that people are entitled to redress in the courts. It's like in the Constitution of the United States of America and the Pennsylvania Constitution. Pennsylvania Constitution, actually, Article 1, Section 6, this is so you think I know something, says the right to trial by jury shall be as heretofore and shall remain inviolate. And that's not a color. And that's those are important concepts. Keep the mic moving. Who wants it? Up here, way up here. All right.
Is there any recent topics that you've seen that just make you go, I would really love to take that on?
Well, I mean, the dirty little secret is that you gotta always check a table before you sit down. I've had this case. I've actually had this case, the case of the folding table in the gymnasium of a Philadelphia school, where they stack the tables. They fold the tables up. They put them in the corner. And then the kindergartners all line up and the tables fell and killed a child. And what we learned is that the bases should have been 16 or 18 inches wider, but they weren't, because there was a memo which said that if you cut them down by about 16 inches, you can pack two more in the truck. And therefore, we can save X amount on shipping. So I've actually had this case. So that's why I'm careful. What's your question?
Is there been any recent particular issue that's really caught your attention that you want to take on, you'd like to be a part of?
Yes, yes, and we are a part of it right now. We are the first law firm in the country to bring lawsuits against the commercialization of sex trafficking.
Thank you for that.
And you're welcome, and to everyone. And what we've been talking about, having a hard time in compartmentalizing, you should sit down with some of these women. It's horrible. And I don't practice what I preach. There's a statute in Pennsylvania, a specific statute, which says that you can sue those who are the economic beneficiaries of sex trafficking. And we've sued the hotels. There's a place in, but you can read about it on our website. My law partner, Nadine Bazark, he deserves the credit, not me. Nadim is in the forefront of this work, and you should read about it. Just go to our website, Nadim Bazar, and read about his cases. And I volunteered to, because you asked, is there something you want to get involved in? Nadim is a very accomplished senior lawyer in our firm, and his law practice is in representing victims of sexual abuse, victims of institutional abuse, and now this new area of sex trafficking. I have volunteered to, in my later part of my career, second chair cases for him, because they're so important. That really means I'm gonna try to, wrangle my way into trying the case with him. But these cases have We have one lead case going on right now, which involves a place called the Roosevelt Inn, which was a place where prostitution rings and pimps ran rampant. And we are running through that place like a bulldozer, like a legal bulldozer. And they are going to pay for their, for not only for their crimes, but for their sins. So that's what we're doing now.
And as a kind of a follow-up, I also wanted to thank you for the work that you did on the Sandusky case, the changes that that brought to universities, the culture in both the university life and Greek life is, there's no words for that. So thank you very much for that.
Thank you for saying so. We have a lot more to do. I was on a local news show the other day talking about the cultural impediments. There was a 17-year-old child, 17-year-olds and children, by the way, 17-year-old child who was killed, died last week, visiting an off-campus fraternity house. You can't police the world. The police can't police the world. We can't police the world. But you have to try every day to do it. Sandusky was a case of speaking up for victims. I represent in that case someone to this day who is a friend of mine. There's nothing wrong with your clients becoming your friends. He was victim five and will always be victim five because he doesn't want to have a name. We made a difference there, and I think we're making a difference in the fraternity life things. I'm fond of saying that that a lawyer's job is not only in a court of law, it's in a court of public opinion. And that's where I've taken a lot of this too. And if you're fortunate enough to be able to be given a microphone, then you have to use it for the public good. And also, the microphone is not like to hear yourself talk or see yourself on TV. And by the way, I'm fond of saying, yeah, it's fun, like, okay, you know, like, but that's not what it's about. What it's about is the cause. Really is. But thank you for saying those kind words. I appreciate it. And I hope that we are making a difference because there's so much work to be done, and you just keep plowing and you keep running into impediments. I've currently been involved a lot. No one's asked the question, but I've currently spent a lot of time in drug and device litigation. By virtue of deregulation and by virtue of companies kind of doing what they want to do or what they can get away with, we have products which you can't trust, and we have medications which you have to be wary of. And if you would see internal company documents every day like I do, and see what people say to each other, spin the data, that's science. I mean, like in the documents, how are we gonna spin this? Manipulate the data, quote, screw with the data. Emails have become the worst enemy of anyone who has to defend their emails. We have a saying that no one really lives by this. Don't put anything in an email that you don't want on the front page of the New York Times. But I have found, this hasn't been asked, but I volunteered this. I've had a varied career. There are lawyers who decide that they want to spend the next 40 years or 50 years of their lives working on defective automotive products. And that's great, like if you have an engineering mind. But I have always been kind of attracted to the next thing and to the next place where I could go and where I could try to make a difference and try to change things. And the biggest problem that I have right now is convincing myself that I'm not 35. Because I still feel that way. As long as I feel that way, as long as I feel that age, I'm going to act that age. As long as I'm going to act that age, I'm going to have fun. So that's kind of what makes me tick. A couple of more. I imagine we're close to wrapping up. You must have class. Yeah, just we're almost there. Pretty much there. I guess we have 10 minutes left, something like that.
Anyone else?
keep this conversation going. I will laugh or cry, whichever you like. Yeah. Yeah, I did. When did my partner and I know that we were ready to go off and start our own firm? I'm trying to think of Jim Beasley, who died 15 years ago, and would be mad at me if I told this story. So I'll tell the story. So I got myself involved in litigation, which involved the drug Vindectin. Actually, a lawyer left the office. This is the inside skinny. Lawyer left the office. She was handling about 30 of these cases, 30 cases involving the drug Vindectin. Vindectin you can actually buy on the market today. It's Unisom, it's doxylamine, and it's an antihistamine. And if you want to feel less dizzy, that's your drug of choice. Not too exciting in the world of drugs. So we had these cases. It was an anti-nausea pill by prescription at the time, and it was associated in laboratory tests and in human testing with causing birth defects, most notably limb defects. And so Jim handed me off these cases. This is a long-winded way to get to the story, the end, but you'll get to the end, why I left the firm. I remember the question. By the way, if you want a really good trial tip, who wants a trial tip question? A really good trial tip question, like a trial team like over here or something. a question I always ask. I did it in the last trial. I do it in every trial. Someone goes off like I'm going off right now, and I just sit there patiently. I usually go and sit down. I usually put my hand in my face, or my face in my hand, and when the person is rambling, I then ask the question, do you remember the question? It is really effective when the person says, would you repeat the question? Because the jury knows that person is advocating, not answering the question. It's a good question. Do you remember the question? Okay, that was thrown in for good measure. So he has these Vindectin cases, my friend in the back, who asked the question all the way in the back. I take on this project, and it was somewhere between a difficult project and an impossible project. The science was difficult. Everything was difficult. How many of you ran across the case of Daubert, also called Daubert? Yes. Yeah, well, there's always somebody who's knows more than the other people.
I
know that. I know that. Even I could figure that out. And so, okay, that case came out of the Vindictive litigation. And so I get the cases, and I start to try the cases one after the other. By the way, if you're working for a great firm and it has good resources, and you're like the young 30-something-year-old lawyer, and you're getting to go to court every week, and you're not paying the cost, hey, you should be game for that, by the way. That's how you learn to try cases, by trying cases. And so I tried a case. I tried a number of these cases, and I tried one which was successful called Blum versus Merrill Dow. That ended up in the Supreme Court of Pennsylvania. I convinced 11 jurors out of 12. We lost a juror. The Pennsylvania Supreme Court said $2 million jury verdict. Supreme Court said, I'm getting to the answer question. The Supreme Court of Pennsylvania said, nope, you didn't get 12 jurors. You need 12 jurors because you lost the deliberative value of the 12th person. And under Pennsylvania law, actually, I have to make this law by losing this case. Your jury verdict is null and void. By the way, and President Gormley, I'm glad you stayed for this, the Pennsylvania Supreme Court reasons, among other things, that you need 12 people, 12 apostles.
I use that case in my class on stakeholder.
There you go. you mentioned that Mr. Kline, the famous alum, lost that case. But I like the 12 apostles thing because it's kind of like you need that 12th person who might go bad on you. So I'm just saying. But that's in the case, in the Supreme Court case. So back here, I had to go retry the case. I'm getting to leaving the firm. I retried the case a second time. That's an interesting exercise to go retry a case the second time. And got a jury verdict, and my punishment by the Supreme Court, remember the Supreme Court said I needed the 12th deliberative person, this time we had a jury of 12, this time the 12 all deliberated and voted, and the jury verdict wasn't $2 million, it was $15 million. So that was all, by the way, good for giggles, until eventually, about 6 years later, the Supreme Court took that away as well. But that's not important to the story. So the day of the verdict, I came back to the office, and Jim said, "How'd you make out?" And I said, "Got it for you, Jim." "How much?" $15 million. And Jim said to me something along the lines of, "Oh." And I mean, in our law firm today, we have a culture where we pop champagne, and we celebrate, and we have a happy hour, and we usually have a bar bill of $2,000. But Jim kind of said, "Oh," and I was unhappy about it. It is the truth of the matter, since we're all now family. I was unhappy about it, and I said to Shane, and I just think, and we're best of friends by that time. He was my junior by a few years at the bar, and 10 years chronologically. And I said, I'm ready when you are. And he wasn't ready. And then something occurred where Shana came to me a year or two later and said, probably they were hearing me tell the story differently, but that's what two witnesses are about. to the same accident. This was an accident. But he said, "I'm ready." And I said, "I'm ready." And I didn't leave for money. I mean, interestingly, I was making, by any account, a very, very good living. But I left because of, and I didn't leave for ego, because I was happy. I left because, and I think there's an object lesson in this. I left because my boss didn't really say congratulations. Like, I thought you should be congratulated on that kind of achievement. I'm being honest, since you asked. And it's one of those life lessons that I've tried to carry forward in now having a law firm that has 45 lawyers in it. And Jim was angry. He called me back the next day, since you didn't ask, but this is a fun story. He called me back the next day, like I was still working for him. And he said to me, and these are tough conversations, being a lawyer is being a person. And Jim called me back and he said, actually his secretary called and said, quote, "Mr. Beasley wants to see you tomorrow morning, 7 a.m. Jim went in early. And I went to the office and he said to me, "You know, Tom, you were like a son to me. And you just walked out the door." And I tried to give him my side of the story. And he said, "You know, you were the executor in my will." And I said to him, "Jim, my working three blocks away doesn't mean that we have to, there's no legal impediment to my continuing to be the executor of your will and your friend." I mean, this is an old school guy and a great guy, by the way, and someone who, in case you haven't figured it out, I really love, really admire, really respect. I like to say to people, I went to the real Beasley School of Law. I said to Jim, "I can still do all of that." And he said to me two words, which were just classic of this man, "Like hell." Fast forward, I didn't expect to be talking about this today, but since you asked. Fast forward, and we really didn't talk very much for a decade. And then I was going to a lawyer event every year in Philadelphia. We have something called the Musmano Award. Michael A. Musmano was a great justice of the Pennsylvania Supreme Court. Musmano Dissents is the book to read. And we're going up the escalator, and Jim didn't want to know how I was doing. We were, you know, one person behind the other on the escalator. This one made it to the top, actually. And he said to me, quote, how's Paula doing? He was very fond of my wife. And I said, not that good. And he pulled me aside. Jim was a very physical man, small but physical. Pulled me aside, like yanked me aside, and said, what's wrong? That's how you know somebody still cares. And egos are fragile in the law. Back to adversarial. Egos are fragile. And if you think breaking up with a boyfriend is hard, or a girlfriend is hard, or breaking up with a spouse is legally more difficult, but that's all just legally more difficult. Breaking up with a law partner is really hard, and egos are fragile, and there are bruises that are inevitable. But we decided that we were going to then try to build a law firm which stood for the principles that Jim stood for. That was the interesting thing. We were going to only do what he was doing. We admired everything that he did, and his guiding principle. His guiding principle is let a jury decide. If you're going to take a case, then you have to be prepared to try the case, and you have to take. If you're going to take a case, it has to be meritorious, and that's why we turned down. I used to say 99 out of 100 cases, but it's probably 999 out of 1,000. I mean, that's because you do it with great advantage as a plaintiff's lawyer. Great advantage. You can select the cases and select the clients. There's no requirement otherwise. So that's my story, and I'm sticking to it. And I am available. If you invited me back, I would come.
We'll always invite you. Thank you.
Go back to class.
Well, we're so honored. Thank you so much.